Well, welcome back, everyone. And we hope you had a great second day here at SINFO. And to close the keynotes for today, we have Leticia Silva. Leticia is a story artist at Cartoon Network, and she's going to give us an amazing talk about storyboarding for animated series. So we hope everyone enjoys this, and please, Leticia, the floor is yours.
Hello, everyone. My name is Leticia Abreu Pinheiro da Silva. I'm a storyboard artist at Cartoon Network, and I'm here to tell you guys about my job and what do I do there. So I'm going to be sharing my screen here, and you guys are going to be... Wait. Can you guys see my screen? Can you guys see my screen now or not? We can't see. Oh, weird. Allow. Okay. Can you see it now? Okay, awesome. Okay, so just jump to this guy here. Sorry. You guys can see it now, right? Okay. Cool. So, I'll put the full screen then. So, I'm a storyboard artist, and I'm going to be showing how to storyboard for animated series. So, these are the shows that I worked for. I worked for DreamWorks for The Adventures of Puss in Boots. I work on the reboot for The Powerpuff Girls, and I work in the show now called Victor and Valentino. So, what's my process? First of all, like, you know, my showrunners, you know, the directors of the show, they give me a script or an outline. And Victor Valentino, they give me an outline, which is like a script, but more a more simplified script, because we're able to create a dialogue in the show. We storyboard artists, we create dialogue. So they give me a script and I usually freak out, like, you know, like all this amount of work I gotta do. And then I start drawing like crazy. And then after I do my drawings and I create the dialogue, I pitch to my crew, and people laugh and enjoy, you know, the episode that I create. And then later on, they give me another script and the whole process starts again. So what we do as storyboard artists, like for animation, we are the cinematographers. We choose the camera angles. When we read the script, you like, we see like, you know, Victor and Valentino are in a forest. So we got to choose like which cameras are going to be using to show them that they're in the forest. So like I use like an extreme long shot to show the forest, and then it's just a close up to show like Victor or Val, you know. So it all depends what I want, because I'm the cinematographer. And when I'm as a storyboard artist, you are the cinematographer as well. And also we are the actors. We actually, we choose how the actor or like how the characters are going to be acting and performing when you do the storyboards as well. And the storyboards, they usually inform the animation studio that we're going to be, you know, that's going to be doing the full animation, how the characters are going to be acting, how, you know, how the shots, you know, are being shot, you know, like, you know, are drawn. And I'm going to be showing you guys more, you know, like, you know, with examples, and you guys be understanding what it is. So I created a pilot called The Wonderful Wingets, and I'm going to be showing what was my thought process when I was creating, you know, as a storyboarding the pilot. So this is like a little, like an outline that I did when I was boarding, because I wrote the pilot as well. So we're going to, you know, read it quickly here. So The Wonderful Wingets, exterior forest, day. The Wonderful Wingets caravan is rushing to get to a new town. Tim is excited to visit such a big town. Interior caravan upstairs, moments later, Tim enters a room where his sister Iris is rehearsing some lines. She's very focused and she dismisses Tim's excitement, saying he has an important role as an actress and she needs to concentrate on that. Tim has an idea. Tim goes downstairs and he asks his mother if he can have a role on tonight's show. His mother tells him that he can help them promote the play. Tim is excited with his new role, and he feels validated by his mom. So, So like, you know, it starts here. The wonderful Wingate's exterior forest, the wonderful Wingate's caravan is rushing to get to a new town. So here, what I did is like, okay, I'm going to create a long shot. We need to see the caravan. The caravan is the house that they live in as well. So I need to show the scenery. I need to show the mood, you know, of this pilot. So here we see the caravan going through a forest. And you can see that like the caravan is huge and it's being driven by like a big snail. And now I want to introduce more about, I want to introduce the characters. So here it's Tim and his dad. So the dad, like, you know, is excited and he says like, look, son, have you ever seen a city that big? And you can see Tim like excitement through his eyes and his smile as well. So those are the informations I got to show the, you know, the viewer, what I'm thinking like, oh, I'm introducing the new characters. I'm introducing this new show. You know, how should I be doing this? So this is what I'm drawing. Like, I'm always thinking like, what is the best way to show? What are my characters feeling? So I have to have all these questions when I'm boarding, when I'm storyboarding. So here, you know, like he talks about like, oh, look at the city. So I'm like, I'm making like, the city appear through the horizon. And now I'm going to introduce a new character, which is Tim's sister. So he's like, sister, check out this big city. So in this shot here, because like, you know, as a storyboard artist, like you're like all the time, you're like, you know, introducing shots, you know, showing new information to the viewers. So in this one, I'm showing like Tim's excitement again and showing this big city like rising through the horizon. And now we introduce Iris, Tim's sister. So she is like, you know, right away, I wanted to introduce her like, you know, rehearsing, because what's her character? She is a type A personality. She wants to be a good actress. She just thinks about acting, in the opposite of Tim, who just wants to have fun. So right now I'm showing those two characters and how they are different from each other. So Tim is like, look at this city, it's huge. And Iris is like rehearsing of all the days in the year. We can explore it together. So, you know, here Tim's excited, Iris rehearsing. And she looks at Tim like, Tim, we didn't come here to the city to play games. We came here to perform. So here I choose a close-up of her because we got to show her expression. We got to show what she's excited about. She's excited about rehearsing and the play they're going to be putting on later tonight, you know, for this big town. So, you know, so as a storyboard artist, you know, we got to like, you know, now I'm choosing to go in a close-up, like in a more like a medium close-up shot to show Iris like, you know, feelings about what she's going to be doing and what she wants. So like, you know, now Tim's comment about Iris, you know, what, you know, like, he's like, you're always so serious. You should have more fun like me. So here again, I'm like, you know, I'm choosing this close up on Tim because like, he's showing like his point of view of the world. You know, he is a kid. He just wants to have fun. Hey, Iris, you should have more fun like me. So here now I'm choosing like this camera to show his feelings and, you know, what he thinks of Iris's point of view, which he doesn't agree. He's like, you're always working, just have to have more fun like me. But Iris here dismisses Tim, and I'm going back to the shot, you know, like when I'm drawing, I'm like, you know what? I need both them again. I need to show how their relationship together, and she's going to dismiss him. She's like, unlike you, I have a job. I'm a valuable artistic member of this caravan. And she leaves Tim's alone. So and Tim's like all by himself, like in a frame, left out. And the whole thing is like this whole pilot is like showing that Tim doesn't feel that he belongs in the family because he doesn't have an important role in this artistic like family. So like here, just left in a frame by himself. There was a conscious choice too to show, you know, how he's feeling. So as a storyboard artist, we always like have to think about that too. What is the character feeling? How we frame, how we draw, you know, how we compose like a shot to show the character's feelings as well. So here, like I go on, like on, you know, on a close up with him and you like here he's thinking, so Tim has an idea. And like now I start with like a close up on the stairs and Tim is all excited. It's like, mom, and like he's jumping. He has his idea and the mom, and like now introduce the mom, which she's the director of the, you know, of the theater troupe. So she's like, and remember, tonight is our troupe's biggest performance. If we can pull this off, we can finally be taken seriously. So here, I pull out and I show all the other members of the caravan, which is the mom and the snake sisters. And I show like how excited mom is and how they're just thinking about like, you know, the play that they're going to put on tonight. And Tim is coming rushing in. And it's like, hey, can I be part of the play too? So here again, you know, he now he's trying to like, you know, be more, you know, included in, you know, in this family dynamic. So here, like, you know, in live action terms, we talk about like, you know, over the shoulder. So like, you know, here it's like a shot, I'm including Tim on the shot too. And I'm like, but I'm concentrating on mom because now it's mom's line. It's like your mom is going to say, you know, she, because like she thinks like Tim is too young to be part of like, of the troupe. So she is like, well, Tim, there are no roles left, but we do need a promoter. Oh, and I have the perfect thing for you. So here, like in mom is not trying to dismiss Tim as Iris was. So I'm choosing this shot to like concentrate on mom and her delivery. And she's trying to still include her son because she loves her son. She's trying to include him in the family, although he's not going to have a role for the play. He's going to help them promote the play when they go to the city. And Tim is excited. He's like, yay! So this is like my job as a storyboard artist. Let me, I'm going to. So like, this is what I do. So all those decisions, you know, like I'm making them, well, I'm drawing them because like in storyboards, we, you know, like we're drawing. In live action, they storyboard too, but they use more as a guide. For animation, we are like, you know, drawing like the key poses and we are drawing the sets, and that's going to be, you know, used almost as a guide too, because we have designers that are going to get all those sets, all those backgrounds, and they're going to be designing them way better than I did. But like they're going to be using all that information to create the final animation, you know, which is really, really cool because like I only do like until a point, you know, and then I deliver all the storyboards to my directors and they deliver the storyboards to the designers who are going to be designing the backgrounds. The character designers are going to be like, you know, designing the characters in a better way. And at Cartoon Network, we don't animate in-house. They get all the storyboards and all like the backgrounds and like the character designs, and they ship those to Korea, to animated studios in Korea, animation studios in Korea, and they will be fully animating the whole thing there. I'm gonna be showing you guys the a little bit of the animation that, you know, of this board that I created, because now it's finished and you guys can see like the difference. It's actually pretty, pretty similar because they use this as a blueprint, but I'm going to be showing you guys because, yeah, it's really pretty. I love, like, you know, even, like, in the animation studios, they even made some choices themselves in animation. Like, they, like, I made it up to here. They made it even better, you know, like, some of the poses, some of the gestures, and, you know, like, and the backgrounds are beautiful. So I'm going to be showing this to you guys right now. Just wait a second. Let me share the screen. Okay. Oh, sorry. Here's some. There. Yeah, so as you guys saying, like, you know, all this work is just like for like a little tiny section of like, you know, of this pilot, the storyboard. So yeah, so like everything that I'm doing, like I'm choosing the camera angles, I'm choosing like, you know, how the actors are going to act. And not only that, like we got to think about like clarity, what is the best way to be shown things, because sometimes like, some things are not clear for the audience. So we need to make everything clear and spelled out, because nobody's going to be there like and telling, how things should be. You're going to have your own experience. So everything needs to be very, very clear. And we make things for kids too. So everything should be super clear. Nothing should be dubious or ambiguous or anything. And also like, besides clarity, what we do is like economy, like, because we only have 11 minutes to like, you know, create a story. So every shot counts. It's almost like a music, you know, like every note is creating like, you know, a whole symphony. It's like, so every shot is there, you know, for a reason, to tell the story, to like, you know, make it sense for the whole story, to like, every shot is there, every drawing is there to like, you know, for a reason, to show information of a character, to show how the character is feeling, or to like advance the plot. Also, like at Cartoon Network, what's interesting is, as I was saying, like as a storyboard artist, like we write the dialogue as well. So it's called storyboard driven shows. And those are really, really fun for us because they are more creative. We get the outline, and the outline doesn't have the dialogue. So while we're drawing the characters, we're writing the dialogue too. And you're creating, you know, the gags and, the dialogue, even like, you know, sometimes we could even like change some plot points if you think it's better. We just need to check in with our showrunners, but they encourage us to like change things for the better. But in a script show, things are very, very different, because in a script, like it's set on stone, we cannot change things. When I worked for Adventures of Puss in Boots, I was given a script, and there I had to follow, you know, everything, and I couldn't change, you know, anything there. But it all depends, you know, depends on the network. Some networks, they have like storyboard driven shows. Some networks, they only have script driven shows. So I enjoy more like writing, and, you know, I enjoy creating gags. You know, I think that's what's more fulfilling to me. So that's what I like to do the most. I just saw that you guys couldn't hear like the pilot, like the Wonderful Wingets, but it's, you know, it's online. You guys can, you know, just Google, and if you put like the Wonderful Wingets, you can watch the whole pilot. Also like for storyboarding for animated like series, what's interesting compared to like, you know, live action, because like they'll, you know, there's live action storyboarding too. We have to like, you know, I don't know if you guys saw in the storyboards that I showed, it's, you know, all the keyframes are there. So we kind of like have to animate and think like as an animator too. We are trained as animators because I went to school for animation, but, you know, some illustrators, they, you know, they do storyboards as well, but we do have to think in motion too. We have to think about the animation principles in order to do the storyboards. And you know, that's a big difference too, like in live action as well. They can move more the camera, like in a 2D show that I work, we can move the camera, but it's a little bit more limited, because it's not 3D. So we can like just spin around the camera, cause that's very, very hard to draw, you know, like not only for us, but for the, artists they're animating in Korea. Like, you know, animating like, you know, a whole background spinning, that would be insane for them. So as in a 2D show, we have limitations as well. But, you know, but those limitations are fun too, because, you know, with 2D, we can create more whimsical things, you know, because it's like drawn. In 3D, you know, there, you know, it'll be very, very expensive to, you know, make a very whimsical background, unless you're Pixar, you know, like, or Disney or DreamWorks, like have like a bigger budget. But, you know, but in 2D, we can like, you know, create, you know, everything because we've just been drawn, but we cannot create like spinning backgrounds or do fancy camera moves. Yeah. I don't know if you guys are like interested in asking maybe some questions right now. I think it'd be maybe easier to even, you know, tell you more about what I do.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Leticia. Now I would ask our chat to post any questions that you may have in order for Leticia to be able to answer them. Let's just wait. Let's see if there's any question already. So Christian Clement is, I'm so surprised. Why is that you outsource the animating itself to Korea?
Oh, it's because, like, first of all, animation, imagine this, every second they do 12 frames, which is like, you know, so we call it two, so like we duplicate every frame, you know, and you know, so it's 12 frames per second.
So you duplicate the frames in order to have that 24 frames per second in order to have that smooth animation.
But like to do that 1 second, the 12 frames, so imagine how many, like, you know, frames are like 11 minutes, right? So we don't have like enough manpower to do it here. And in Korea, I think, you know, maybe it's cheaper too because of the currency and everything. Mm-hmm. So we cannot animate ourselves. So we need to send to a studio that they have like a bunch of animators, not just one, two or three. They have like, you know, a whole team to, you know, to create the animation there. But I do create the animation keys that they call. That's like the key poses, you know, like the poses that tell a story. I create those. But then between, you know, like, you know, the drawings in between, that's what the Korean artists.
Is there any like communication between you and the animators over on Korea, or once you send the storyboard, it's all up to them, right?
So when I created the Wonderful Wingets, I had communication with them. That's usually the showrunner, the, you know, the director of the show. Yep. You know, like they have that communication. They can, you know, they send to Korea, they inform them what they want. And then they actually send some pencil tests sometimes. I got some pencil tests from the Wonderful Wingets. And then I was like, this is not working. Maybe I should, you know, make another pose here. Or just like, oh, the timing isn't correct. Maybe fix the timing here. Or like, you know, we do that a lot. And after even it's animated, there's something called retakes. So we ask them to like, hey, this shot, like this animation didn't work. We know we want to make it something different. So we call a retake. Yeah.
Okay. So let's see. I didn't miss anything. So Chuck Norris asks, the final version was really similar to your drawings. Is this the regular thing from the storyboarder to the final show? The aesthetics not changing that much? Or usually it was a coincidence?
Okay, so what's interesting is like for 2D, we try to be as precise as possible.
Okay.
You know, because they're going to be using those drawings for keys. But for 3D shows, like The Adventures of Puss in Boots that work at DreamWorks, that one is 3D, so I can draw in any style I want, you know, because it doesn't matter, because they're going to have the models and the rigs, you know, like they're just going to be using that storyboard as a guide. For 2D animated series, they kind of use it more. They use like that drawing to create the key pose. So that's different, yeah, for 3D shows.
Beatriz Pereira asks, do you have any advice to start a career in illustration?
Yeah, okay, so I'm actually from Brazil. I went to fine arts in Brazil, but like storyboarding, I kind of learned on my own. I took some courses, like online courses and courses with like some professional artists, but there's so many resources right now online that you can learn on your own. But I do recommend maybe taking a class or, you know, one class or two with like professionals, because there are a lot of professionals that teach storyboarding out there. So I would recommend that. But for illustration, for like the first thing I'll tell you, if you want to join this career, you got to draw. Like I remember when I really thought about pursuing storyboarding, I was drawing like 8 to 10 hours a day, every day. So just so you like, you'll be comfortable drawing, because you need to learn how to draw first. You're not only copying a drawing, you got to like, you know, think about a pose and draw that pose, because that's the most important, because like when I'm storyboarding, I'm acting too. Sometimes I'm like, oh my God, how does Victor is gonna like say this to Valentino? So I gotta act it out, and then I think about my pose, and I even do my pose. I swipe my pose, and then I draw.
Yeah.
Because you gotta feel like, you gotta see what your character will be doing.
Right. And so since we're talking about the principles and classes that you took, how does principles of cinematography apply to storyboarding? You mentioned choosing a wide shot than a focused shot. So is it important for people when starting storyboarding knowing these things, or?
Oh, totally. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Like you kind of learn, like I bought books and stuff, but I really learned by doing it and like paying attention. Because when I watch a movie, now I watch a movie, I just think about cinematography. Like I, you know, yeah, like I watch them like, oh my God, like they broke their 180. Oh my God, this cut was weird.
Yeah.
You know, so we really start paying attention to all those things. Yes, for sure. Like you gotta be learning a lot, the rules of cinematography. But you learn a lot too by doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So like a cinematographer, they get a camera, they start shooting things, they learn by doing it. You learn by doing storyboards too, and you think what it works, what doesn't work.
Right. José Simões asks, were you also responsible for the character design?
So for The Wonderful Wingets, yes. I had a character design with me, my friend Chase Stanley, but like both of us were like back and forth in the designs. But for Victor Valentino, I have designed some characters, like, you know, we don't have a design for a character in a storyboard, like in an outline.
Mm-hmm.
There's like character A, and I'm like, oh, we don't have a design for that. And my showrunner's like, oh, just think about something.
Yeah.
And then I draw, and then they use that drawing as an inspiration for the design. So sometimes there are characters that are not designed, and we do that first take, and they use that as an inspiration to design the character, and it kind of looks similar to what we designed first in the storyboards.
Okay, great. Then Daniela Figueiredo asks, do you have any portfolio advice for trying to get a first job as a storyboard artist?
Yeah. Okay. So when I did my storyboards, I was trying to get a job in animation. I created my own stories because I like writing.
Yeah. That's a great idea.
Yeah. So like I wrote my own stories and I create like short stories and I made into a portfolio. I would like do that. Because why I chose to be a storyboard artist, because I love storytelling, I love stories, I love writing. So if you like that too, you can like, you know, create your own stories and draw them and create a portfolio in that way.
Mm-hmm.
Because, and the recruiters and the, you know, the people hiring you, they appreciate that. At Cartoon Network, they want people that create their own stories because we are storyboard driven shows. So they want to see if you can write a dialogue as well, and you can create things from scratch. But like other studios, they're just interested in the draftsmanship and how well we can tell a story, like through cameras, you know, like that's more like 3D boarding, I would say. That one, and maybe if you don't want to write, you just want to draw, you can get a script online. You can get like, you know, things that people have written online or like even from a book, and you can board from that too. Yeah.
Awesome. Chuck Norris again asks, what are the main pros and of working in animated series versus working in animated movies?
Oh, okay. So right now it's kind of blending, you know, things. But okay, so animated movies, what I've heard, because I've never really worked like in a, you know, in feature, but I have a lot of friends working feature, a lot of friends. They have more time, thanks, which is a luxury for us because we have 5 weeks to do an 11-minute episode.
Yeah.
But I have a board partner, so it's like five and a half.
Wow.
Yeah. So we are always on the clock.
Yeah.
You know, we cannot take breaks. It's like after we finish an episode, they give us another like outline and have to board again. For live action, I heard they have some downtime. They finish a sequence and then they wait a week to get another one. I don't have that luxury, but their job is really, really hard too, because I think the drawings, they need to be more polished because they do have the time in order to create those storyboards. I'm used to my sloppy drawings, they're not sloppy,
Yeah.
they look like the characters, but they're just a little bit more rough.
Yeah,
Yeah.
so in terms of that, it's actually a good thing for kind of getting the general idea for then the animators do the work and not focusing so much in the detail of the story, because again, you have so much little time to do that, right?
Yes.
Right. So Juan Sanchez asks, assuming you receive the plot of the story, how do you divide it in boards? What is the decision process on that?
So yeah, so I was showing to you guys. So for instance, I get an outline, and and as I said, the caravan is going through the forest,
mm-hmm.
and I'm like, okay, there's so many ways to show that.
Yeah,
I can put a camera on top. I chose the camera to be kind of in front of it. I could have
a lower
angle, putting the camera very low and show how the caravan is very, very big.
Mm-hmm.
But I chose that shot because I thought it was more clear, and I wanted to show the characters there too, the little characters there, and I wanted to show the snail. So for me, it was just a matter of clarity. That's why I chose that. So, but there are so many ways. There's no right or wrong
or
way.
Wrong way, yeah.
But there are ways that are more clear. They have more clarity to the audience, and there's some other ways that are more obscure or but it all depends. You're the cinematographer. You're almost like a mini director when you're a storyboard artist.
Mm-hmm.
It's your decision, but then you have to please your boss. So if they think that was not clear, they think that's not working. I want this shot. So we have to do it because it's not your show.
Yeah. Okay. Moving to Andrea Plica's question. What principles? Oh, I already asked this one. let's see. Besides animators, which are the other persons involved on the final product? Is your job more a team or single oriented? I think you kind of briefly talked about it, but
yeah. No, there. Okay, so there are a lot of people. So Cartoon Network, we work more with the pre-production, which means it's we don't animate, right? We do the things before animation. So we have storyboard artists, we have writers that write the outline, we have the storyboard artists, we have the storyboard directors.
Mm-hmm.
After we finish the storyboard, they get that storyboard and they maybe touch some things. They're like, oh, maybe this should be better this way. So they touch things here and there.
Right.
And then we have revisionists that after the storyboard goes to animatic. So they need to put the storyboards in a timeline with the voices and everything. Sometimes things are not working, or the network, they give us notes like, hey, we didn't like this scene. I think we should be changing to this. So we got to do those changes. So the revisionists are the ones that be drawing those changes. And also in the art department, because that's the story department.
Mm-hmm.
In the art department, we have background designers. They do the layouts,
yeah.
The backgrounds for the animation. We have painters that paint the backgrounds. We have character designers who will be drawing the model sheet of the characters. I don't know if you guys have seen it. They draw the characters and they rotate the characters to inform how the characters look in every angle.
Mm-hmm.
We have prop designers because we need
really?
Someone to design the props. We have color stylists. So color stylists are the people that they choose the colors of the characters.
Okay.
Because we have the background painters who choose the colors for the backgrounds. And then we have color stylists that choose the colors for the characters. Because, okay, you guys know, color depends on the lighting.
Yeah.
So if there's a background that's very dark, that character who has a yellow shirt, that yellow tint is going to be different in a darker background.
Yeah.
So they do that job.
Okay.
They have to inform what colors of the characters are in that specific background. And we also have production, production assistants, coordinators, that helps us with schedule. We have the animatic editor, someone's going to be editing the animatic,
mm-hmm.
Which is the storyboards and the timeline. And what else we have? Yeah, I think
you touched
it.
On everything.
Yeah.
So other question is there a scene from a script you found particularly hard to storyboard? And if so, why?
Oh, there's so many hard things to storyboard.
Just pick one.
for instance, Okay, there's some like just outlines that are just really hard, that they are not clear. There's one right now that I'm working on that it's like, oh wow, this is so, it's just like really, really hard right now to like sometimes wrap my head around the story. For instance, like when I was working Adventure of Puss in Boots, we have a lot of like sword fighting.
Okay.
And I'm not a sword fighter. Yeah. And I'm more a comedy storyboarder. I like writing comedy. I like boarding comedy. I did board like that, but I thought it was very, very difficult because you have to look at reference, you have to watch movies and how, because it's not like just this. It's like, I have to just look at the choreography, if they was going to swing like this, how the other guy's going to block the sword,
Since we were talking about this, how is that like choreography? Do you come up with the choreography?
Yeah,
really?
It's really hard.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think I succeed that well with that job because there's some people who really love that. They thrive for that. You know, I would rather, I'm storyboarding right now this fight sequence like for this one, but like fighting is easier than sword fighting because the sword fighting you really have to like really look, you know, like because there are specific moves and everything. I think like action sequence that involve choreography are very, very hard.
Awesome. I'm seeing if there's any question that I might have missed. I don't think so, but I might have one question of my own, which is, so how is it to change between art styles? So do you do that often? Because like one series might follow a specific art style and other follows a completely different art style. Is that something you find easy to switch around or...
Yeah, it's interesting because like we as a storyboard artist, we have our own style.
Exactly,
because like our drawings are going to be the final product. Mm-hmm. Even when I draw like, you know, the characters in my own way, there's another artist that's going to be drawing
right.
my drawing.
Yeah.
But there are shows, for instance, like, you know, Avatar, right? That's like a more realistic show. Mm-hmm. So I would have to like, you know, practice and drawing that style for a while in order to be comfortable, because like every time you go to a new show, it takes time for you to be comfortable in that drawing style, because like Victor Valentino, Powerpuff Girls, those are very like cartoony, you know, shows.
Yeah.
But if you're going to form more like, you know, Korra, Avatar, you know, Voltron, all those shows, it requires more like, you know, a volumetric style. So you have to practice that. So we as artists, we gotta like do a little bit of homework, you know, drawing the characters in that way. I remember my former director in Powerpuff Girls, her name is Fitzy, she went to Spirit at DreamWorks and she never drew horses before. She's like, oh my God, now I gotta draw horses and it's a 3D show. I gotta draw horses in every angle. I remember going to her office and she'd be like drawing horses the whole time because she was moving to this other show. So she had to do that homework. She had to like, you know, learn how to draw horses
mm-hmm.
in order to work in that show, because there are horses like running, going different angles, you know, like turning. So I have to draw all that. I drew horses for, you know, Victor Valentino.
And horses are, I would say, a hard animal to draw because they have like all these muscles.
I draw humans, but like, you know, of course, like I have a character designer, like who drew an animal there, you know, and I just like look and I look at some reference, like, okay. And then, you know, I had to do a little bit of homework. I have to like drawing a little bit more on the side and then I start drawing.
Yeah. So I think we have another question. I have read that Pixar does a really intense job in that area, the research outside the movie, like the sword fighting, because of your tight schedules, you can't do that much research, or isn't it just the Cartoon Network's culture?
No, we can do the research. It's just like for TV, we just have such a tight deadline.
Mm-hmm.
We have to do like, actually there's this board that I'm doing right now. There's a fight sequence. And, you know, and I have to do it and I have to like look at like some kung fu movies and stuff like that. But I haven't boarded that part yet.
Yeah.
Like, I'm, you know, the weekend I'm going to be doing that. I'm going to be looking, you know, seeing, you know, a little bit like how they do things, and even like, you know, get inspiration for some shots, because it's like a an action moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I'm going to be boarding. So we do have, we have time to do that, but we have to do that during the weekend, you know, just because our job is so intense. We have so many, we have to do like, you know, 50, 60 panels a day in order to like, you know, deliver our quote, you know? Yeah.
Yeah. So I was thinking that storyboard artists, that does it really have like a parallel to concept artists? Because a concept artist, I would say that it draws like the general idea of, let's say, a background or an environment, and storyboard artists also like is like also this, but with the intent of a story. Would you say that there's a clear parallel between those,
for sure,
those artists?
Yeah, because like we're the first people to visualize, like, you know, things. So like if there's a, like a long shot of this waterfall, beautiful, we have to design that shot.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be pretty as a concept artist would do, because they can paint and they have like all that detail. We do things like very, very limited detail.
You know,
we just like need to sell the shot. We just like, if it's just like it's communicating the idea, great. Because then someone's going to get that and put it, you know, bring to the next level.
Yeah, exactly. Well, thank you very much, Leticia. I think we are closing the session.